Lord, we thank you for enabling us to express our hearts to you unabashed, to express our hearts to you with great joy. Thank you for enabling us to connect with zeal to you, Lord. Thank you for bringing a substance of your reality into our conscious presence, Lord. I thank you. I humbly thank you. I ask you, Lord, to step into our midst and breathe fresh and new upon us. Breathe upon us. We choose to be your disciples, and this is the discipleship hour. You've breathed upon your disciples. We declare we want to sit at your feet. And we come and ask you to breathe upon us, to receive your mighty word, to receive your instruction, not from a man, but, oh, Lord, I ask you to illuminate it to us in such a way that we would hear your voice in the midst of the teaching. Only you can do that. Only you have the power to open our eyes and our ears. So we ask you for understanding. I ask you for anointing, so that your word becomes spirit-born, spirit-breathed, and life in us. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. We're continuing in our study on Ephesians, being hopefully good disciples. I want you to know Jesus didn't send us out to save the world. His pointing finger to go and make disciples of men unto me. So we're not supposed to make disciples of men unto organizations or denominations or to ourselves. But we are supposed to teach people how to hear God, how to receive from Jesus our Lord, how to become spiritually conscious and sit at his feet to become his disciple. He's the only one that can teach us these things. And he desires to do so through the Spirit, through his word, and, oh yeah, sometimes by revelation, revealing himself, revealing the truth, putting the truth plainly on the table in person. It takes eyes, spiritual eyes, to have these encounters, and spiritual hearts to receive them. Spiritual understanding even to perceive those. But just like we developed eyes and ears in our mother's womb, we're supposed to be in the womb of the Spirit. We're supposed to be resting with him. Him hovering all around us, developing the spiritual senses we need to abide with a spiritual God, a spiritual Lord and King of this universe. Eventually, we will be totally changed and transformed, and we will only be spiritual beings. In the meantime, there's part of us that we have to deal with, and that part is not accommodating to us becoming spiritual men and women of God. The flesh part of us cannot perceive him, cannot understand him, and wants to do all kinds of religious works so that we can feel good about ourselves. The Holy Spirit in Jesus wants to engraft us in until we are completely a spiritual being so that we can abide habitually, where we could live and move and have our being in Jesus by him being in us. Remember the overall goal in the book of Ephesians, 14 times in the first chapter, that somehow we are to get Christ into us. It's not a matter of just magic words. It's not a matter of just an invitation. It's a matter of keeping yourself in the open position spiritually so that all of you can leave into Christ and all of him can come and be in you. If I only do that an hour a day, I'm only having a transfer an hour a day. That's why we're supposed to habitually live with that openness of come, Lord Jesus, in all things, abiding with him in all things. Because if he is present, then the change will take place. If we hold that thought there for a moment, Lord, and we run out to do something in this life, and we're not attentive to his presence, we're not attentive to being where he commanded us to be, to receive from him. He chooses the time, he chooses the place, we do not. If we're not attentive in that, then our spiritual growth is somewhat slow. We see others sometimes surpass us, go beyond us, and begin to have experiences with the living God that we're not having. That can be frustrating. The book of Ephesians, as I've expressed to you, is not a book of correction like all the rest of the books. It is a book designed by the Holy Spirit, penned by the Holy Spirit, to a church of over 50,000 people that abided every moment of the day in his presence, that moved in the fullness of Jesus, the fullness of the Spirit, with manifestations of Jesus himself being a constant thing. So much so that it's written that they all came to the same truth, the same revelation, the same understanding. But they were a Gentile church. They didn't have the Old Testament. The New Testament had not been written. It was a church that Jesus himself stood in to reveal himself. And get your picture of that in the first seven letters to the churches in the book of Revelation. In there, he gives us an encapsulation to each one of the churches, the problem that they were having and still having visitations of them. He begins in each one of the letters with the encapsulation of logikion in the Greek, of him saying, I'm standing here. I'm in person. My eyes are fired. My feet are like white brass. Why can't you see me anymore? Why can't you hear me? He summarizes each one of the letters after pointing out what was wrong and why they had stopped hearing him and moving and living and have their being in his presence, commanding them to get ears, commanding them to hear what the Spirit has to say, which implies they'd stopped hearing what the Spirit had to say. Church has not changed. It still belongs to Jesus Christ. He's still supposed to manifest himself. And if he's not manifesting himself, either that church has turned into a Samaritan church that no longer belongs to him, or a pseudo church that has cast him out. A Pharisaical church that no longer acknowledges him and has exchanged knowledge as the God and knowledge about him and what happened in the past and what will happen at the rapture. Pharisees were involved in that, so much so that they denied the living God that was standing in front of them. My whole point in giving you these scenarios is that the Holy Spirit, through Paul, is penning something to us. And we have to understand, remember who it's penned to. It's to the faithful. It's to those that are having experiences, to those who are hearing him, to those who are walking with him, to those who are seeing him, to those who are his trained, to those who are his righteous. It is not a letter to the world. It is a letter to men and women to carry them into deeper, further experience in God, so that the God of the Old Testament that was real to the Israelites, that walked with them, that stood on the mountain, that the mountain shook, the land shook, the earthquakes going forth, and great tornadic fires in the sky, and lightning and rumbling of his voice, to where every man, woman, and child stood and heard him speak all of his commandments. It was just not Moses. That's the God that wants to reveal himself to us. We need that concept of him being in our midst, and the reality of that. So this book, above all other books, is considered the treasure of all Scripture, because it comes forth plainly and states, this is the life, this is the walk, this is the revelation, this is who Christ not only was, but who he should be to you right now, not will be in the future. Because the problem with our Christianity today, we either want to talk about the Christ who was or the Christ who will be. And what you will be held accountable for is the Christ who is, and whether you walked with him here, and whether you hear his voice or not. He said, my sheep hear my voice. I consistently remind you, the litmus test, y'all come in and have a chair. The litmus test that you will have to pass should make you sweat bullets. I would like it so much if he would come up and would you expound the 863 exegesics that I put forth as a pattern for mankind. I would love it if he would come and say, will you give me all the information about this and the history of that? Oh, yeah. Here. You get 100. You get an A. But I fear it's going to be different. He's going to look you in the eye. And he, with his lips, with sweat coming off of your brow, will either make the statement, I do not know you, or make the statement, I know you. Come in. So our whole assignment in the short lifespan that we have is to make sure we connect to him. Not to the point that we confess we know him, but to the point that he walks with us and abides with us, and he's so thrilled that he keeps revealing himself so that he knows us. There's the test. I think somehow us theologians have made it too difficult. I was listening to some paper that Tristan was writing, and he was having to do a write-up on a book, and it was humorous. I laughed all the way through it because of what the men were saying, the economy of God, the ecology of God, the all these metaphoric words that had no meaning to us as Christians. It was empty and void of the presence and breath of Christ, and it was all about pneumatics and words and schemes and languages that men have penned about God. And they were debating as to, the question was, the central question, do you believe and don't you think that the theology about God should be conformed to fit humanity in whatever state it is supposed to be in and changing in the future? Please respond to whether you agree with this statement or not. Whether it should fit with society and its changes, whether it should fit with, and I loved his answer. It's way over my head. I think it was way over his head. He said so in his letter. But my point is, these men are looking for something they cannot see, something they cannot hear, because if we're going to see and if we're going to hear, it's through spiritual eyes. Man without the Spirit, without the Holy Spirit, cannot even perceive the things of God. And they're staring so far out into space that they miss his presence altogether. By way of example, I have a cute little thing for you. Sherlock Holmes goes on a camping trip with Dr. Watson. After a good dinner and a bottle of wine, they retired for the night to go to sleep. Some hours later, Holmes wakes up and nudges his friend. Watson, Watson, look up at the sky and tell me what you see. Watson yawns and opens his eyes and he says, I see millions of stars. Holmes says, what do you deduce from that? Watson pondered for a moment. Well, astronomically, it tells me that there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets out there. Astrologically, I observed that Saturn is in Leo. Hermologically, I deduced that the time is approximately 3:15. Theologically, I can see that God is all-powerful and that we are a small and insignificant part of the universe. What does it tell you, Holmes? Holmes paused for a moment and said, "The tent's missing." I think in our zeal and study about God, we flat miss His presence that's supposed to be here. I think theologians are trying to look to the second coming instead of to His residence presence. Our salvation is not about His second coming. Our salvation is about Him walking with us now, and us hearing Him now, and us knowing Him now. Because if it's not hearing and knowing Him now, then when we get there, there is no salvation. My crowd makes me real nervous, because I believe in healing. I believe in the resurrection of the dead. I believe in miracles. I come from the Southern Baptist background that didn't believe in that. But my crowd that believes in those things and practices those things, it's my crowd that's going to be lined up. It's my crowd that's going to be gnashing their teeth and saying, "We healed the sick, we raised the dead, we did all these things in your name." And Jesus looks straight in their eye and says, "I don't know you. You are a worker of iniquity." Paraphrase, it means you did these things for your own vainglory, using my power and my might so that you could glorify yourself, and you didn't use the time to get to know me. Now that makes me real nervous. It changed my theology several years ago to the theology, "I must know you, my Lord. I must walk with you. I must learn how to hear your voice. I'm assured that if I hear his voice and walk with him, I'm assured that he will look me in the eye. If he can look me in the eye here and I become aware of it, and he says, 'Well done, good and faithful servant,' then I will not fear that day." That "well done, good, faithful servant" is not about me going and doing things for him. That "well done, good and faithful servant" is one that has sat at his feet and has learned to deduce, instead of astronomically of what's going to happen in the future, "What is your bidding to me, O Master, this day, this hour, this moment? What is your will for me?" I noticed that most men who became real renowned men of God weren't in a hurry to go do something for God as much as they were pulling themselves aside to rest with Him and be in His presence. Those who were the greatest witness are those who spent time with Him, not those who went and did things for Him. Now, my point in giving us this is we're in Ephesians, we're going to be starting chapter 3, but we must connect chapter 2 to chapter 3. This is the super view from the satellite. You remember we sometimes get the close-in view with the micro camera. Yes. But this view, we've got to go all the way out to outer space to catch it. Because something's being said here. If you remember in our last session, we were dealing with apostles and prophets being the foundation. How can they be our part of our foundation? I mean, the word says that. And we, in the evangelical world, or from the evangelical background, don't even acknowledge those offices exist. But yet Jesus is the one that assigned them, and God the Father is the one that handpicks them. God's the Father is the one that designated them. But I can tell you, in the circles I came from, Southern Baptist background, we did away with them. It makes me nervous. Anytime I see something done away with in the Word, I think there's error. Because God is the same yesterday, and He's the same forever. So, if we're still talking about apostles and prophets in the end of chapter 2, but chapter 2 builds upon chapter 3. And what's God trying to show us? We did a whole session on prophets, and we did a whole session on apostles. And you know, that's not the focus of this entire study. The focus of this study is the book that's written to a people of how they could even go deeper in God. And so what's being established by the Holy Spirit and penned is all the areas that need to be shored up to make sure that they continue in that deeper walk with God, in being able to abide into His presence. So he pens that our relationship, the whole household of God, us becoming citizens in the kingdom of God, have been built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets in Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building is being fitted together. It grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. My thought process when I wrap my mind around this, I have to come back and remind myself of verse 11 in chapter 2. Therefore, remember that you once were Gentiles in the flesh. You were called the uncircumcised by what is called the circumcision, made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ. You were being aliens in the commonwealth or the citizenship of Israel. You were an alien. You were strangers from the covenants and promises, having no hope. Now that I highlighted for you the strangers from the covenants and promises. Because think of this. What is this gospel? Because there's all kinds of renditions of the gospel. I just almost got sick yesterday reading commentaries as I was preparing for, I'm doing a whole session on the book of Proverbs, and I was preparing and looking into different aspects and reading dozens of different commentaries. And you know, I like to use scripture for its own reference point. I don't trust commentaries. I read them so that I can see the error that's being poured in the church, so I can bring out the truth in the scripture so that we can correct any error that has been dumped into us. And I just was absolutely amazed. They thought the gospel was about, every one of them I read in threw it into the future. It had nothing to do with now. It had to do with you breathing four easy words, Jesus, I receive you. That's it. Slap you on the back and say, okay, you've got it all. You're filled with the Spirit. You're walking with God. You're His. You're His bride. And then, now the hope of God is within you. The revelation of God is within you. The Spirit of God is within you. All the knowledge of God, all of His riches. Grab the sword. Grab the shield. Grab all the power. I mean, it was page after page after page, book after book after book. Their whole thought about the gospel was one about your eternal salvation. Now, I gave you a definition what of eternal salvation. Every time you see eternal life in Scripture, I think because men have muddied the water what eternal life is, us theologians, we have cannibalized that word. Eternal means from the beginning to the end. But when it's used in a theocratic society, it's only talking about after Jesus comes. That splitting of the sky. There's your eternal life. When truly what it means is the perpetual abiding presence of the living God from the time you first heard of Him until eternity, which never ends. So that's a different concept. And it's being peddled different. Now, I know the source of that. I've shared it with you before. 125 years ago, it was two heretic professors that got hold of some Gnostic writings from the 2nd century and decided to reintroduce those back into society. And one by one, all the great seminaries began to assimilate those doctrines, and to the point that it did away with Christ. It did away with the power of Christ. It did away with the holiness of God. It did away with the power of the Spirit. It did away with miracles. It did away... It did away with the presence of Jesus to the point that the church no longer is a holder, a revelatory holder of His presence. God made us to be a revelatory people that could walk in His presence, to be a holder of God's breath, and we lost that. Jesus returns to redeem us. The Holy Spirit comes to sanctify us, to get us back to the state, to become a revelatory holder of the breath of God inside us again, because we cannot commune with God without the breath of God in us. And I want you to know, I've given it to you in some of the other passages of Scripture. When we receive Jesus Christ, we receive the Spirit of Christ. But it's not the Holy Spirit. There's three of Him. That rankled my feathers when I was younger. I'm kind of used to it now. Jesus, being one member of the Godhead, went to the river and was baptized, and the second member of the Godhead came in Him. When He received power, He was able to accomplish what the Father was doing, because the two members of the Godhead connected to the executor, which is God Himself, of what God the Father wanted done. Our teaching is not about receiving the Spirit. Our teaching is in chapter 3, but I'm laying a ground, and we will get there. Shall we go on? Let's begin in chapter 3. Now, we just got through reading about that He's trying to express to the Ephesians. You were Gentiles. You didn't have any promise or any covenants. And now He comes in and He said, here's how you acquired the promise and the covenants. It's through the foundation of the apostles and prophets. And Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. And that you're being built together by the Holy Spirit to be a dwelling place that God's presence will come down and stand in. I did a foundation series for you. 39 steps of how to be in a position to become the temple and getting the foundation laid where all three members of the Godhead can come and stand inside you, where you can commune with Him. I mean, if the weight of all three members of the Godhead stood in one spot, you would collapse. So there has to be a foundation laid, and the foundation is for us to be able to support His coming and His presence in our life. There's much work to do to accomplish that. And the Apostle Paul, through the Holy Spirit, is illuminating those things to us that we might connect to those things. So he says, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, and that prisoner also can be translated in the Greek as the bondservant of Jesus Christ, or I am in bonds to Him. I cannot do anything else. I don't want to do anything. I am His slave so that I can minister to you, is what he's saying. So he's driving home the point that the Gentiles, which, raise your hand, that's what you are unless you're a Jew. I'm a Gentile. I don't have a Jewish heritage. I don't have a Jewish covenant. There was a different covenant that was made with them. I have a different covenant. My covenant is the covenant of the Gentiles made through Jesus Christ, the covenant that He made with Himself to redeem me back into God's presence and to engraft me in. I didn't have a covenant, remember? It says, if you indeed have heard the dispensation, and that word dispensation is also administration, or it can be the administration of the government of God in the power of His presence and charis in the Greek, which is His grace. Now, I remind you that charis is real similar to charisma. Charis is the gifts of God that He sends to it. The charisma is the activated gifts of His power in our midst. So when you see grace, don't think of it just as, oh, well, that means I have His favor. It also can mean the dispensation of something that God has arranged and placed on the table filled with His gifts and His power. And in this case, Paul was made the administrator of all the gifts of God to the Gentiles, was he not? He went forth doing every manner of miracle there was, raising the dead, healing the sick. He was an administrator, but he doesn't take to the bank talking about miracles as much as he does about the gospel. So don't you think we need to find out what the definition of the gospel is? Because if we have a wrong definition of the gospel, see, I from the Baptist background, I was taught the gospel is, okay, Jesus died on the cross and He saved me and I'll have eternal life, and that's the gospel. Not according to what Paul's fixing to say. You're fixing to get in some deep water here, so over your head it's like you're walking in the little kiddie pool and thinking about salvation and thinking about the doctrines of God and thinking about that we know the meaning, and all of a sudden there's this drop off and you're over the Mariana Trench. Now, anybody know how deep Mariana is? Like 35,000 feet deep out there in the ocean, in the Pacific Ocean, deepest spot on planet Earth, which the weight of the water would crush you. You would be about less than a half inch in diameter if you settled all the way to the bottom because of the pressure. The more deeper we go into God, the more he compacts us and it squeezes the impurities out of us. I need that. I don't like that, but I need that. I don't smile about it, but I need that. I need the impurities. And the only place I can get the impurities squeezed out of me is to get into the deep things of God. And I'm not talking about the phony, baloney, name it and claim it and everything else that goes on out there. I'm talking about the real living presence of God. And you know I believe in miracles. You know I believe in healing. You know we participate in these things. But it's not for us to command those things to happen. If we are, then we're in danger. Why? It's because we're using God's power for our own glory. Jesus only did what he saw the Father doing. He walks into a crowd, and there's some 300 in one report, 700 in another report. Around the pool of Bethesda, there were seven different porticoes built around there. He did not heal everyone. He sees God healing only one in the midst of the crowd. He looks up, and he sees what the Father's doing. He walks over to the one person and says, "Do you want to be healed?" Well, every time the water stirred, I can't get down in there because you can see the multitude around, and they beat me there, and I'm paraplegic, you know. It takes me a while to drag the rest of my body over there. Jesus asking, "Do you want to be healed?" Which is a good question for us. Do we want our spiritual ineptness to be healed? Jesus has his hand out to us, offering to heal our inabilities. We don't have to wait for the stirring of the water. If we can just turn to him and connect to him and the revelational epigenos, remember epigenos? Experiential knowledge of God. See, there's genos, that's just knowledge about, but everything that's talked about in Scripture is in Jesus appearing and us hearing in him, us walking with him. It's always referred to as epigenos in the Greek. It's a revelational, experiential walk with God. So with that in mind, let's get on here. I'm going to read in context chapter 3 so we can get our view from out of the satellite. "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for you Gentiles. If indeed you have heard of the dispensation, the administration of God's government and grace of God, which was given to me." Who is that administration given to? Paul. He declares it boldly. Not only did he say above that the foundation of your relationship with Jesus Christ, of being able to see him, hear him, walk with him, it's built on the foundations of the apostles, it's built on the foundations of the prophet, it's built on the foundation of Jesus himself standing in our midst, being the chief cornerstone that you can see. Paraphrased for you. We can look up the rest of the scriptures if you have a problem with that. Let's go on here. "So this dispensation of grace was given to me for you, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery." That is the word mysterion in the Hebrew, it and in the Greek. It means that things that are hidden, that are private to God concerning the future, concerning all spirituality, concerning the revelations of heaven, concerning, like John. When John hears a voice and says, "Come up here." In the Latin, that's hypatsu, which some translators say rapture. He wasn't raptured. He went up there in person. And the next thing he knows, he's there. He said, whether in body or not, I don't know. But before this, Jesus was standing beside him, and his eyes were fire, and his legs were like bronze. Fire was coming out of him, and he's speaking to him. He didn't recognize him, even though they were best friends at one time. Revelation is taking place. Hypatsu is now standing, observing things from God's presence. That observance of things that God is in, that observance of seeing the throne room scene, the elders take off their crowns, that observance of Jesus Christ showing and him seeing the Ram of God on the throne as though he was slain, That observance of the constitution of God being handed to Jesus for the future of all mankind and all celestial beings in heaven. Because time and everything had ceased and nothing could carry on. And heaven was standing and waiting because nothing could carry on. And John said, I wept because there was no one to open the scroll. Things could not go on. Him witnessing Jesus unrolling the scroll, it meant our future now is made at hand. Him witnessing these things is this the same revelatory word used in mysterion. Well, Paul has said that I was given charge in regard to the revelation of God. I was given charge not only by the revelation, but it took me into the mysteries of Christ. So that's my whole point, is to take you into these things. It is his office and his charge before God to bring and keep the church in the revelatory position of not being fruits and nuts. Revelatory position of God manifesting himself. And this is the problem I have. Many churches that have a manifestation of the Spirit, it's like, it's out of control. And if God is present, there's 10 million times much more control than there is if he's not present. Everything is done in decency and order if God is present. A true manifestation of God is one of pure order. And that's not necessarily quiet. They're standing there in the throne room and they're shouting, glory to God. Why? Because the Spirit is moving upon them and they can see how great he is. And there's one unison response of on their faces. One unison response of worship. Nothing in chaos, everything ordered. The mystery, how that the revelation he made known to me, the mystery. And he says, as I have briefly written to you, by which you have read, you may understand, and he's writing this so that you may understand the knowledge of the mystery of Christ. Now that is, that's gnos, that's not epigenos. But the mystery makes it epigenos. Why? Because he's saying, I want to take you into experiential revelational understanding. And now when knowledge becomes experiential revelatory understanding, it becomes epigenos. It's changed and transformed into epigenos. Your relation with God is supposed to be hear about God. I believe that. Receive more about God and then begin to experience God. So that it's not something up here. It's something, a reality begins in here. So much so that there's a yearning inside you. So much so that there's things begin to happen inside you that drive you, that you've got to be in God's presence. You can't live without him. There's a thirst that's created with you. There's a hunger for righteousness, a hunger to know him. When our conscious mind comes to the understanding that Jesus Christ is here and we each have the opportunity to know him, we each have the opportunity to be in his audience. We each have the opportunity to personally be trained by him. We each have the opportunity for him to reveal himself to us. In Titus, it talks about him revealing himself. His great appearing in our midst. And my club said, oh, well, that means at the second coming. It says nothing about that in Titus. It says his great appearing. That our hope of our life and our perpetual relationship with God is supposed to be based upon his great appearing in our midst. I wasn't raised that way. I was raised being told Jesus Christ is up there on the throne and he doesn't come here anymore and he didn't talk, sonny. Just get that out of your head. He doesn't speak. Last time he spoke was in his word and I'm the holder of his word and I'll tell you what he said. Oh, I wept for years because inside me there was a longing. I mean, a crying. I'd go to church and I'd hear, get saved. Okay. I thought I was, you know. Come to the altar and repent. I'd go to the altar and I don't know of anything I've done, Lord. I would cry, I would weep, and inside me there was a groaning, oh God, I want to know you. I'd go to the pastors and sit with them. Can you teach me how to hear him? Oh, I feel him calling inside. I don't know how to connect. How do I connect with him? Pastor after pastor said, that's not possible. You expect too much. That doesn't happen. That dispensation died. And I want you to know, it frustrated me to have someone that's supposed to be representation of God tell me that God doesn't speak anymore. It broke my heart, although I knew no other theology. It broke my abiding. I threw that off several times, and I would press in, oh, but Jesus, I know you're real. I remember meeting. I remember asking you to come inside me. There was something that took place. There was a great experience in you. And they'd tell me, I just slowed down. You know, experience is not everything. Oh, God. I really frustrated the grace of God. I'm calling the grace of God the revelatory understanding that is supposed to be available to us. Because the revelatory understanding is not given to the world, and they're missing the graces that come in understanding and perceiving in relationship. They're missing the grace that turns into the graces, which every one of the gifts of the Spirit. You know what gifts of the Spirit are? When you read the word gifts in the Greek, it's the same word as grace. The grace of tongues, the grace of prophecy, the grace of miracles, the grace of laying on of hands, the grace of God manifesting himself. It was just translated as gifts instead of grace. So that changes the puzzle a little bit when we think, well, grace just doesn't mean his unmerited favor. Grace is his awesome presence. And then when it's connected to other words, which we're fixing to see, a connection to other words. He says, how by revelation he made known to the mystery, as have I briefly written to you, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. When you read it, you begin to understand the mysteries that Christ has given. Wouldn't it have been a marvelous thing to sit with John and talk to him about him standing in heaven? And he said, he briefly writes to you, oh yeah, I had a throne room scene with God. You want to talk about it? I'd be glad to tell you about all the graces that he gave me for giving me that experience. But Paul just throws that out there lightly, saying the mysteries of God. There's indications that he was trained personally by Jesus Christ where we're 3.5 years out in the desert of Damascus. Several theologians agree to that. The Gnostics do not. Let's get on back in the Word. He wants to clarify. He said, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mysteries of Christ. Holy Spirit is trying to establish in their heart and their mind. There was only one apostle that was given to us. It was Paul. Peter and the rest of the apostles were sent to the Jews. The great outpouring of the Spirit began by Peter going to Cornelius' house, and he wasn't willing to give them salvation, but the Holy Spirit moved upon him and said, speak and give them the truth. Give them the message that I'm here and I'm alive and I'm the Messiah. And Peter, he's reluctant, and God has to give him a vision and says, don't call what I call clean unclean. Whatever I make clean's clean. Go there. He goes, which was unlawful for him to. He speaks of God, which was unlawful for him to do that. He goes into their house, which was unlawful for him to do that. He can be cut off from the house of God by doing these violations according to Scripture. He was contaminated. He would have had to gone through several rituals and confessions of him violating the law and explaining why he violated the law. And while he's giving his little pep talk and speech, the Holy Spirit falls upon them. And he, my goodness, they're receiving their heavenly language and they're prophesying, and here comes the tornadic fires and resting upon. It says it happened to them just like it did to us. What happened to them on the day of Pentecost? Tornadic fires dropped out of the sky that 1.5 million people could see all over the whole city. It says the whole city come running to see what this was. No fires out of heaven had been seen since the time of God stood upon the holy mountain. And the earth shook, and men were a witness of the fire. No fire had been seen since man had walked with God through the desert for 40 years. And in the ancient rabbinicals, the Hebrews account that every time sacrifice was given and when God became in residence, a tornadic fire dropped out of the sky, and it was right over the Holy of Holies where God was. So it was significant when 1.5 million people see the wind blowing and tornadic fires coming and heading for the temple, and they all go running to the upper room to see, what is this? Another one of those things that's called mysterion. It was real. It was something from the spiritual becoming tangible in our world and physical in our world, so that the two worlds become connected. That's what Paul is trying to express, what the Holy Spirit is trying to express. If we want to become connected in these two worlds, where the spiritual becomes tangible, there's things in this Godhead of the fivefold ministry that can be accessed to change us, where we can become beings that get the transfer of the spiritual into the physical. It's not on happenstance. Not every once in a while. Everything that Jesus did, he constantly was in contact with the Father of how to do it. Our great achievement in this life should be to do it Jesus' way, in his presence. Whatever we do that is outside of him, the scripture says, is sin. He requires that we do everything within him. So shall we go on in the scripture? He makes the point. He says, I want you to know, there is no age that man has known about these things. He says, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men. He's talking about the mysteries that Jesus has given him to reveal to the church. He says, it's not known. Jesus Christ has come in and given me these mysteries, and you can be a holder of these mysteries too. But Jesus made it so it's supposed to come through him to us. And that's why we see a church there that developed and became nearly 50,000 strong. He goes on to say, and it has now been revealed by the Holy Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets. Who was it revealed to first? Why? So that they could be the witness of it. And not only that, God gave them the instructions of how to bring us into it. Not by hearsay. Not by happenstance. He gave them the instructions of how to carry the church into real relationship with the living God. How to carry the church so that they could enter into mysterion. So that they could enter into the revelation of God. Your walk with God is supposed to be one that's revelatory. That's a fancy word that we in the Baptist realm get real nervous about. What it means is God revealing Jesus to us. Or the Holy Spirit revealing. Now, I'm not too nervous about him revealing something. But when we use revelation, ooh, spooky. It means revealing. We're supposed to live in a constant revealing, a new revealing. I mean, I used to love when my little girls were little, a constantly showing them something new and hearing them squeal. Squeal for delight. I looked for new experiences that I could take them to. I looked for new things to show them. I looked to, you know, I remember that first time taking them up in an airplane and all the squeals of woo! And I remember the nervousness, you know, and say, okay, y'all want to lean the plane over a little bit? And my oldest daughter, no, 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 no. Okay, honey, just hold my hand here, and I'll just lean it over a little bit. and you look out, you know, turn the plane over a little bit and where she can see out, and she's, and you know, she got calm, she got used to it. And I take her to the next thing, and I take her to the next thing. She finally got to the point she wasn't tearing the upholstery off the seat. We get nervous when God offers us a view into a place we're not from, into a place we're not qualified to see, in a place where it's dangerous to be a holder of that knowledge unless you belong to Jesus. She didn't have to worry. She was with me. I wasn't going to throw her out the door. That wasn't my intent in taking her up in an airplane. And my other daughter, she's a yahoo! You know? You know, can you make it go up and down, Daddy? My other daughter, oh, we are so different. Some of us want a great ride with God, and others just give me a pew that's flat so I can sit on it. You know, some of us are ready to get up there and see our God. And I'm sure it was a frightful thing to behold Jesus Christ with his eyes of fire and his feet of bronze, which meant that he is the King of Kings there for judgment. I'm sure it was a frightful thing. But after the experience, now he talks, oh, I heard a voice behind me. It was the one I used to lay my head into his breast. I didn't recognize him at first. And when I turned around, I stumbled backwards. These eyes of fire, hair white as snow, and his legs and feet were on fire. And then I heard the voice, John. Don't you remember me? I'm Jesus. He didn't recognize him, but to receive the comfort, to get the understanding and to calm down. Calm down to the point, hey, John, I want you to take some dictation for me. Can you do that? Get out your ballpoint. And he begins to dictate. I want you to write this letter to the seven angels of these seven churches. Now, who's going to deliver that? And how do you get it to them? And what do you write it upon? I would submit to you that our Lord is the one that provided the pen. He's the one that provided the ink. He's the one that provided the post. And he's the one that provided the paper. Because it was not written to men. It was written to seven angels, and it was delivered. I don't know if you believe God or not, but that's what it says in the Word. That's a little beyond our comprehension. Now, my good buddies in the theological world, we have, he must mean the pastors of those churches. Surely he was referring to the angels being the pastors. Because we do not really think that, I mean, angels, that means angels would have to talk. And we know angels don't talk, and I mean angels have to be there, and we know they're stuck up in heaven and we're his representatives. I mean, I can go on and on about reams of stuff that makes me want to throw up when the scripture says it plainly. It was sent to the seven angels of the seven churches, and that those angels would make the presence of Jesus manifest there in their presence. Because I don't know if you've read the seven letters or not, but it was a real manifestation in some real churches that had some real problems and had lost the ability to walk with God and hear God and sense God and know God. So he's saying, this mystery has been given to me to give to you. God gave me this gift to give to you. And he's placed me in the position. That's the only reason I live. I am his prisoner and I am captive to give this to you. I have no other purpose in life. My life means nothing. My God says I am his prisoner to deliver this to you so that you can enter this mystery too. I praise God that he sent Paul to bring some of these things to light to me as a Gentile. Because I don't have a Jewish mind. I don't have the history that they had. I don't have the understanding that they had. I didn't have the relationship that they had. I didn't have the experiences that they had. They walked with God for 40 years. He was in and out of their nation for thousands of years. We don't have that experience to count upon. We come into it and engrafted into it, and we have to be told about it. And now that telling somehow has to become revelatory. It has to become the mysterion to attract us. It has to penetrate our hearts so that it becomes real in our mind, and there's illumination that's added to it so that we can understand it, because our forefathers did not experience it. Right. Yeah. So the Holy Spirit comes close. He said, I'm ready to go. I'm heading in. He comes rushing in with a revelation of, oh God, you're real. Oh God, you're here. How do I connect with you? There should be the question. We cry out. Now Paul is going to begin to answer some of those things. Holy Spirit's going to begin to answer some of those things in this book as we continue on. He's going to begin to present more and more understanding that we're supposed to be walking in a revelatory experiential functionality with God. Till we get the vision of it. Till we can see it in our mind. Till the mysterion becomes real here. Because when I get flashes of it here, it stirs faith in my heart. And you cannot connect with God unless you have faith. And it takes the revelatory experiential thing of the expressions of this great apostle to bring them to light so that I can believe. And then as I believe, Word explodes. As I believe, more of the dimensions of Christ become real. As I believe, more of Him becomes real. And it all comes because Paul, the Holy Spirit, comes in and says, look at this mystery. Experience these things. Now I want you to express these things to them in reality. And this is the gospel that you're expressing, that I'm in their midst. This is the truth. Bring the reality that the kingdom of God exists. The kingdom of God is here. That I am here. That's the gospel. That's not a mamby-pamby thing of the future. It's coming into the mysterion through the revelatory process that the great apostles have penned for us. And as we hear, perceive, it stirs up revelation so that revelation can become real. And we move into the mysterion, the mysteries of the reality of Christ. The holders of knowledge will never enter into the mysteries of Christ. They'll talk about Him. I even have a whole bunch of people in my club, the name it and claim it. The only reason they wanted Jesus is so I can be in power, I can be in charge, I can command demons, I can cast them out, I. And I remember reminding you that there's the Holy Trinity. Who is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? And who's the holy, unholy Trinity?
Me, myself, and I.
We were God before He was supposed to become God. And if it's all about me, all about, I command that to happen. I'm just, wow. Anything happen? Now, I grant you, there's a few healings, but it's not because of my faith. Somebody else maybe was touched by God, not by me. That's not part of our study. A little freebie out there for you. And so let's continue on in our study, shall we? How long have we been going, Tristan?
1 hour.
1 hour. And we just barely got started. I hate that. I got to at least read you the blimp, let's read. He just got through saying in other ages this has never been known. These mysteries have not. As it has been revealed by the Spirit to His holy apostles and prophets, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of the promises of Christ. How are we partakers of the promises of Christ? Through the gospel. But whose gospel? It's got to be Paul's gospel. He said, if anyone else comes to you and tries to teach you any other gospel, count it as from the pit. I don't care if they're an angel of light. So you think we need to investigate and find out what Paul's gospel is? Mm-hmm. We'll probably end up doing that in our next session because we barely got started here. Mm-hmm. Of which I became a minister. Many translations it says, in which I became your minister. Mm. I like that. I like to think God sent him to be the chief apostle to the Gentiles. I understand Jesus Christ is the chief apostle of the whole church. Mm-hmm. But that's the whole church. You got the whole Jewish tribe, which that church grew to probably 500,000 people in the Jewish realms. And then it started to fade away and the Gentile church comes on the scene. Why? Because the rest of the Jews rejected it. Too much persecution. Mm-hmm. He said, in which I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by the effectual working of his great power. That effectual and great power, the two words together, means the coexisting living presence of God expressed through his dunamis in the Greek. Dunamis, if you take the universe and squeeze it into a little bitty nutshell and then let go of it and it explodes, you got dunamis. Mm-hmm. It'd make a big mess if you're close. You better get way back because it is the big boom. Dunamis of God accomplishes the great will of God. Then he goes on to talk about the purposes of the mystery. Why was it given to him? It was given to him whom I am less than the least of all these saints, this grace was given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. There's another part of the gospel, the unsearchable riches of Christ. Have you heard those? Do you know those? Do you know how to get into those? The unsearchable riches means you can't find it. You don't know how to search for it. I mean, it's like going into a library. You don't have a library card. It's a library with real books in it, but you're blind. You don't know the captions, you don't know the titles, you don't know the authors, and you don't know anybody to ask, and you can't hear anybody. Oh, but you're deaf too. Forgot to tell you that. Now, try to check out a book. And if you did, you couldn't read it. So he's saying, these unsearchable riches, you don't understand it. You're standing in the vault of Jesus Christ. All the knowledge of the Godhead and the expressed riches waiting to be assigned here in this library. And I'm here to help you check out these books. I'm here to help you give you eyes. I'm here as his library assistant to bring the revelation of God to you so that you can experience him yourself. And to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery. You catch that. Now he's just not talking about the mysterion that he went into. He's saying, I want you to experience this fellowship in the mysterion. And who is that with? It's with Jesus. There's a direct invitation of not only him having gone there, but now him saying, let me teach you how to get there. Let me teach you how to get into mysterion. Let me teach you how to walk in the revelatory presence of this living God instead of just being in and out and doing things for him. Let me teach you and impart these things to you because that's what God sent him for, was impartation. I don't think there's anything that we receive in our lives unless it's imparted by God. It has to be through an impartation.
That's right.
You didn't even believe on your own. It says no man even comes to him unless he draws. And there must be an impartation of you even being drawn to him.
That's right.
There must be an impartation to you for you to be led into the mysteries. And one thing that office is supposed to do is be able to lead you into your personal mysteries, not make you sit at their feet. Mm-hmm. To get you to see Jesus so you can worship him. Not exalt them in their glory for getting you there. No man's supposed to stand between you and Christ. Paul didn't try to do that. A bunch of men wanted to worship him on an island. He ripped his clothes and, no, don't do it. Worship God. He would not receive it. That's the mark of one of these guys. The mark of Paul. Let's go on here and we'll hopefully get through the rest of the scripture and probably close in about another 10 minutes. The unsearchable riches of Christ he's made available to make all see what is the fellowship of this mysterion, which from the beginning of the ages had been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in heavenly places. Ooh, now there is a deep, deep chasm. What he's saying is, if you enter into these mysteries, see, John got to go into a different age. An angel stuck here in this age. He doesn't move through time. John jumped through like six different times and gives us six different time accounts in the book of Revelation. He said, then he showed me, then I was here, then I went there. There's all these six different times that took place in there. Angels don't get to jump around. The church, when it begins to move in the revelatory mysterion of Jesus Christ and begins to encounter him, and he says, come up here, I got some things to show you. And the reason I know he says that is because he says, I don't plan anything, I don't do anything, I don't write anything unless I share it with one of my men first. God loves sharing these things. I love sharing things with my kids when they were little. I love sharing things with them still. It's a marvel, it's a delight to share things with them. Our God delights in sharing his plans. And guess who gets to overhear that's stuck in this time zone with us? The angels. They get to hear something they didn't know was going to take place. They're not all-knowing creatures. They're stuck in time. We're in a time zone. I don't know if you know that. And there are angels assigned here. And there are some angels that go back and forth. But there are some angels that are assigned here. There's some that stand before the throne. But John gives an account of the great white throne. John gives an account of the end times. They know nothing of that, other than what the Father has shared with them. But the church, when it enters into the revelatory expressions, they overhear these things. It says they delight to hear these things. Isn't that strange that angels can learn something from us if we walk in the revelatory presence of Christ? Food for thought for you. You can do a whole study on that. Let's go on here. These things are that to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God, that manifold wisdom of God, you remember the seven spirits of God that we've talked about before, that's in the book of Revelation, also accounted in the candlestick that's or the menorah that's in the holy place. That manifold wisdom. That's the seven spirits of God. There's manifold wisdom. A manifold is like a pipe that's got several different connections on it. I worked in the oil field and we had manifolds all the time. You got a manifold on your car. Mm-hmm. A manifold means it's connected to several different places. Meaning that manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church. The church has lost that manifold wisdom because it's lost the presence of Christ and the presence of the revelatory mysterion of the Holy Spirit that brings the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we've got nothing to purport to angels. And if you got nothing to purport to an angel, I imagine they're pretty bored with you. You think I'm kidding? I'm not. I believe the word. It says they're here. I believe the word that they're here to help us in our works. Amen. I believe the word when it talks about they don't understand us not believing. They don't understand our slowness and our thick-headedness. They don't understand our not getting it on. They understand the great powers of God, and they understand they're supposed to be flowing through you and I. And they come and look and why isn't it flowing through you? So it's a mystery to them. They think, man, God made all of his power available. If you can just connect with him and become his agent, Why aren't you his agent? And look at each other and all kinds of weird expressions. Like, they don't get it. Ah, there's Paul. God's expressing it through his apostle so they can get over into the mysterion, get over into the revelatory, so that they understand we're here and understand the celestial family and understand that they're supposed to be a part of us and we're supposed to be a part of them. Matter of fact, didn't they read chapter 2 that says we're all supposed to be members of the celestial family? Shall we go on? I want you to know that all these things are according to God's eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him. It just got through saying in chapter 2 that we can actually go in behind the veil, that we actually have access to the Father. See, if we're not going to go into the spiritual realm through the Spirit, if we're not going to go into the revelatory mysterion, how do we ever expect to stand before the Father? Because if you want your marching orders, if you want your identity, if you want to know what your name is, if you want to know what your purpose is, you don't receive that from the Holy Spirit. You don't receive that from Jesus. You receive that by standing in front of the Father. Why do you think Jesus made the statement, I am the forerunner going before you to establish the way. I ripped the veil. I made it where no man would stand between you and the Father again. And there's where my Pentecostal friends have fallen short, including myself in some of my history. I thought receiving the Spirit was the end all. I had Jesus, I received the Spirit. What's the Spirit here for? I receive Jesus so that I can be sanctified. I receive the Spirit so the Holy Spirit can illuminate more of Jesus so I can get to know him. I can be trained by him. So I can be dressed and arrayed by him. And there comes a day in my maturity and walking with Jesus Christ through the Spirit that he says, let me take you to the Father today. He has much to say to you. He has plans for you. Let me take you to the Father. There's the Trinity. We leave out that position. Why would Jesus Christ be interceding before the throne for us? Why would he be serving at an altar in the true tabernacle as high priest for us? Why would he make the statement, I am the forerunner going before you to establish the way? You might come too. In our spiritual progress, in our infancy, if you want to call it that, when I received Jesus Christ, I was born as an infant and I had to grow to receive faith, to receive the Holy Spirit. Then I was an infant again and I had to grow into maturity. And then when I get into maturity, the Holy Spirit finally shines the light on so I can get revelatory understanding, the mysterion of Christ, where he can speak to me, where I can begin to become his sheep by listening and hearing his voice and being trained by him. And then finally there comes a day, says, I'm going to take you to the Father. Be ready for this. Jesus got training too for us, but so that he can introduce us to the Father. There's real maturity. When you stand before the Father, Jesus received his marching orders. Jesus has all power and all authority, and all things were given unto him. He has not left his Father out of the picture. Father still plays a role in this too, but we leave that out. My whole point in giving this to you is for this reason. I bow my knee to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named. Didn't I just tell you where you get your name? From the Father. That he would grant you according to the riches of his glory. We're going to have a whole other session on this because we're talking about supernatural grants here. Our government gives out some petty grants. And we keep talking about one thing in here. The gospel. I would give you this. The gospel is the constitution of God making you a citizen in the kingdom of God. Now, In becoming a citizen, the Constitution lays down for you all the instructions of how to come into relationship with the living God. That's what the true gospel is. How to maintain that relationship with the living God here on earth. That's what the true gospel is. It is a constitution of rights God gives you, and someone has to come and teach you all the legal precepts about living in a society of rules governed by the Spirit, through the Spirit, for the Father, in Jesus' name. We haven't yet become able to hear all the gospel. All the truths of being able to stand in His presence. We'll get into that in our next session. We have about 10 pages to cover about the revelatory gospel, about the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel of God, the gospel of the kingdom of God, the gospel of peace, the gospel of His presence, the gospel of your functionality with God. We'll be getting into these in our next session. Shall we bow our hearts before the Lord? Oh, Lord. Lord, I need snorkel and fins to get out into some of the deeper water. I trust you that you're capable of carrying us there with your great word. I thank you for your breath. I ask you to enable us to be holders of your truth. Enable us to hang on to the things we've heard you speak and shake off anything that was heard from any man. The only thing of value is the things that come through the Spirit from you. So help us hang on to those and put them within our heart and never forgive them and never forsake them. You offer things that are beyond our comprehension. And the airplane kind of tips over a little bit, we get nervous. But help calm us. Help us to see we're truly little children. We've not yet achieved standing before the Father on a consistent basis. We've not yet achieved standing in Jesus' presence and being trained by Him on a consistent basis. We've not achieved being able to walk in the Spirit on a consistent basis. So we admit gleefully that we are little children. We ask you for your help. We ask you to train us by your word, by your great apostles. I praise you for this, Lord Jesus. Let us grab your mysterion and sense you revealing yourself to us. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I think we're in about the 10th session or 12th session of this study on the book of Ephesians. If you would like to get caught up, those teachings are available. I think. 18? Oh, we're in study number 18 of the book of Ephesians. I know the Lord was speaking to you. I could feel Him. I know He touched on several areas. This is your time. If God has truly spoken to you, anytime He spoke to the Israelites, it required a reply, a proclamation of what He has said. This is a special time for you that we're still able to do because we're a small body. Enjoy it while you can. What revelation did God give you out of His word? What proclamation would you make? Remember, this is not as something you heard last week or some other experience or not 5 hours or not 3 days ago. What did He speak to you out of His Word right here and right now. Ball's in your court. That's waiting with the microphone. If you'd like to bow your heart with me and say this in prayer for a moment, that might be better. That way you won't be conscious. That way you'll express your heart to the Lord. You raise your hand when you're ready. Ball's in your court.
Lord, I listened as hard as I could tonight, but I know that I don't understand hardly any of what was said. But I know that there's such a deep, deep desire in my heart to enter into these deeper things, into more of the mystery and more of the revelation of the breadth and the width and the depth of the gospel that is offered to us. And I just ask, Lord, that as You put that desire in my heart, that You'd fulfill that desire. Help me to know and understand what all this is about. Help me to experience it and to for it, so it'll become a part of my being. I need Your help in that, and I ask for it, Lord.
Quickly now.
Father, I'm so excited about the prospect of learning and seeing more of who You are, more of Your mysteries, Lord. For me, the gospel just got a lot bigger and a lot more interesting. And I'm looking so forward to seeing even more of You revealed in my life. And to Father, think of that there are mysteries. Lord, we all love a mystery created in our hearts that we want to understand, we want to comprehend, we want to experience something beyond ourselves. And Lord, that You have a heart that wants to, is excited to show that to us and reveal that to us. Lord, I look forward to more of this ability, this impartation, Lord. I look forward to receiving from You.
Anyone else?
Lord, You own this vessel. But I'm here to say, who can grasp it all? But Lord, whatever I can glean and learn, I'm here, I'm available, I'm ready for learning, for change. Just do Your will in me, Lord.
Father, since I've had it reiterated to me that I may so address You, I was very caught by the phrase, the unsearchable riches of Christ. I don't think I ever noticed that before. But I want to pray and proclaim that I trust and believe that these can be made known. Because Paul himself, who so humbly announces himself as the least of all the saints, as he is about to unfold this before the readers, says that he was commissioned, anointed, to make this known to us, that we might not have to read over those phrases, both hopelessly and hopefully, that maybe we understand. And Father, I've always thought of the phrase of the manifold wisdom of Christ, meaning something was just multi-partitioned, and I guess that's kind of what it is. But I've never even tried to figure out what this really means. If they're truly unsearchable, and you truly send your humble apostles among us to teach us, then I want to say, I believe that some of this can become known even to me. And I thank you, and I await this, because this is how I understand what was delivered tonight and what was read to us tonight. So I speak to you in Jesus' name, Father. I trust you.
Anyone else?
Lord, I trust you too, that you will accomplish those things in me that are your will and your purpose. Holy Spirit, because of your abiding presence in me, I pray that there will be a place not only for the Word of God to land, but to stay and to open up and to bring the revealing of the glorious Christ in me. How I thank you, Lord, for the privilege of where we are and the time that we live. I know that you saved the best wine to last. Oh, Jesus, none of us are worthy of it. But, oh God, how I thank you that we can walk this road together. How I praise you, Lord, for the privilege.
Anyone else?
Lord, I want to acknowledge tonight that I heard your voice in the midst of the teaching. I want to respond, Lord, to you. Thank you, Lord, for calling us into the mystery of God, a mystery that can be understood because you have laid it out for us. I come, Lord Jesus, tonight to enter into that, and to be taught by you and to hear your voice. Thank you for speaking, Lord.
Anyone else? Angie?
Lord, it was made so real to me this evening that I'm not the only one to hear, to understand, because if I obey, then these incredible creatures that God has created also get to hear. Oh, Lord, that puts more responsibility upon my shoulders. I've been such a child at times, Lord. Oh, I'll do that later if you speak to me. Oh, but Lord, obedience to you. Obedience to you, my Father, is not something to take lightly. God, forgive me for when I have failed you and you have spoken. And I thank you for your long suffering to continue to work with this vessel. May I be found worthy to continue on, Father. And that those that are in charge over me or around me will be also enlightened because I have obeyed. Oh, thank you, Lord. And I pray that your Holy Spirit will just continue to strengthen me where I am weak, because your word says that. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name.
Anyone else? Let us go.
Lord Jesus, thank you for bringing me here to share and with these people my revelation tonight. Lord, the enemy is continually trying to sift me, and I want to apologize and ask for forgiveness for my faithlessness, Lord. And I ask that you strengthen my will through you. And I ask that you give me the strength to walk in righteousness with you, Lord. Mm-hmm. Tonight, the whole night was a revelation for me. Lord, every day you open my eyes more and more, and I praise you and I thank you.
Amen. Anyone else? Last call.
Father, I just thank you for being a patient and loving God to me, Lord, for so graciously pouring your love into me by the power of your Holy Spirit, Father. I thank you so much. I just feel such an overwhelming sense of your patience and kindness toward me, Lord, that you desire to reveal yourself to me even when I just close my eyes so hard. And I'm so sorry, Lord, but I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful for the way that you love me so patiently and gently remind me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Anyone else? Last call. Last call, last call. I know there's one more.
I would like to make a request of the Lord, and that is, Jesus, I'm asking you if you would bring me to a place where I'm ready and where you could take me before the Father, where I could go with you before the Father and hear the things that he would say to me. I ask for that, Lord. Prepare me and make me ready, I pray.
Last call. Anyone else? Have the Lord speak to you.
Lord, I know you didn't bring us to, you didn't redeem us, save us just to drop the ball. You've left us a crumb of bread, or a trail of breadcrumbs and a carrot. You're bringing us along, Lord. We just gotta acknowledge you in your ways. You've given us the tools. You've led the crumb of bread, or the trail of breadcrumbs. That you've shown us a carrot. You're not going to take that carrot away from us, Lord. You're not going to dangle it there and jerk us away. We're going to chew on that carrot and know you more. And there's going to be something else ahead of us, Lord. And we're going to be in that garden of yours just grazing. I can see it now, Lord. And I just thank you for that. You are faithful.
Yeah. Anyone else? Last call. Like that. Thank you, people in Texas and different congregations there for joining us. People in England and Canada, Kansas, Nevada, New England, California, Alaska. Pray that God liberally blessed you. Continue to be his student. Continue to abide in his presence. He can make himself known to you. Be his faithful ones. God bless you. Final comment, anyone?
Praise Jesus.
Amen.
With that, if y'all would help put up the fort, I think we will disassemble.